Anyway, so this is my view this morning. I'm wearing my socks still. And it's time to get up and make a fire and put on some hot water. Sun's come up over there somewhere. But the clouds came over last night, which is why it warmed up a little. Anyway, we're all well. Happy birthday to me.
Happy birthday to you.
So I was going to show you all a fancy method of starting a fire with flint and steel and dryer lint. But it's just way too easy to pull up some short, really dry sage brush. And it starts burning immediately. So you don't have a lot of time to... The fire's going already, sure, you betcha.
Wow.
Yeah, you just pull that stuff, that dead stuff out of the ground, yeah, that dead sage, or even kind of dead sage, and it just goes crazy.
That's the advantage of me sitting up here in the tent waiting for you to get it all going.
And that's an advantage, yep, clearly an advantage.
And that little heater thing up here?
Yep.
It's almost dry in here.
Oh, good. Yeah. Huh, dried out in the tent already, sounds like.
Flame-resistant
fabric. Anyway, the sun's come out and I'm hearing geese. Yep. So, it's a beautiful day and we've got a fire going already. Now, the juniper and the sage burns really fast and really hot, but I don't know if you can see this on our chairs, but the chairs are just covered with soot and ash. So tip number, I don't know, what is this, 12 14? Yeah, put your chairs away or upwind of the fire before you go to bed. So I've repositioned the ready light here, catch the first rays of the sun since they're just coming out now, and it's partly cloudy, so I'm sure we'll get some sun. Well, right now, we pretty much blew into town on Friday, unloaded a few things, and then just took off. We didn't really stock the van with the Jeep. So we're out here with whatever we have, and whatever we have is good enough because we're going to try Mountain House meals. And all you really need is a method of heating water and then some way to stir up the water into the Mountain House meal, and that's what we're having for breakfast and probably lunch and maybe dinner. We'll see. But it doesn't have to be complicated. It can be very, just as simple. Okay, just a quick walk around the campground. I've got the ham radio going because Casey at Coyote Works is out here somewhere too, and he's got his license now, and so we've been talking back and forth via the Hampton repeater. He's quite a ways further east in the Glass Buttes area, and we're here at a dry lake in the middle of nowhere, basically.
Best place to be.
There's Monica. She's fixing her hair. Evidently it broke during the night. So she's fixing it. And
my face, my hair, everything broke last night.
And I had the big idea of plugging in my drone batteries into my fridge because there's a USB connection on this fridge. But I forgot that the gang charger there is 110, and so we pulled the Jackery down. It's now drawing 52 watts, actually, believe it or not, charging those three drone batteries. So, and meanwhile, back at camp, we have a nice fire going. The juniper burns hot, but it burns quick, so have a good supply on hand. And I'm hoping that my water is about hot there. And that's Tangerine, the drone. Tangerine 2, because Tangerine 1 is at the bottom of the ocean somewhere. Anyway, that's another story. And one of the things I don't like about these Coleman butane stoves here is that if it's cold outside at all and the butane can gets cold, it actually slows down a little, which I would say is weird, but it's not, because we know that cooler temperatures are, butane doesn't work quite as well. And we're thinking about going with a two burner propane stove, but I didn't want to carry around two different styles of fuel, which means we'd be carrying around butane for the little heater and propane for a stove. But I think it'll probably work out better. We'll see. Our chairs are covered with ash this morning, but it's dry, really dry, and with just a rag it wipes right up. I'll wipe right off. Of course, we could just sit on it, let our clothes pick it up. I can't think of a better way to spend my birthday than to be out in the wilderness getting birthday wishes on Facebook from all my friends. We actually have two or three bars of 3G here, so in the middle of nowhere, so we're not as far out as I thought. Need to do a little map recon, but anyway. Yep, happy birthday from several people, so happy 67th birthday. Isn't that nice? I'm almost 70. I can hardly wait. Oh well, it's coming to all of us, including you guys. And I just hope you're as healthy as I am. And with any luck, I've got another 20 years. Oh, I have a phone call. Hey Monica, what's for breakfast?
Well, we have a bucket for breakfast.
Yes, we're gonna try this out. Mountain House Adventure Meals. Since we're on an adventure, we're gonna try them out. I think you pull here. Yep.
Zip it around.
And then you lift here and here, wherever it says lift. Oh, wind's coming up. Hope it...
You can do it. I know you can.
Okay.
So this is when we just
They don't make
go.
It easy. So yes,
We just went.
Left the house. Didn't go by the grocery store. Bought a few sandwiches for yesterday. And we thought that we would eat Mountain House meals. Oh, there's some granola for you.
Ooh, yeah.
And give it a try. Chicken fried rice. You want something for breakfast?
Yeah.
Let's see if there's anything here for breakfast. Beef stew.
We're heating up water.
Looks like I'm going to have to empty the box in order to find the breakfast.
Breakfast is not on top.
No. Why would it be on top?
I don't know. We can have spaghetti. Classic spaghetti. Oh, we got double spaghetti. Spaghetti must be good.
Okay, so guess what?
There's no breakfast. Granola is the only breakfast there is.
Granola is the only breakfast in here.
So let's see. I like beef stroganoff.
Do you?
Yeah. You want to have that for breakfast?
Okay, we can have beef. How many does that feed? Two?
Hopefully. Because there's only two of us.
I think it probably is, two meals.
Ready so, in 10 minutes. Just add water.
Granola with milk, blueberries. So you mix this with some hot water and it makes kind of like a granola oatmeal thingy.
That would be good. Does it have honey in it?
Let me see. We have someone here who's allergic to honey. And
my
let's see.
My eyes get swollen up worse than they already are.
It has granola made out of oats, brown sugar. I don't see any honey at all. Nope, good. No honey.
We are in good shape. That's...
So this makes how many servings? 2 servings. So we could have this or beef stroganoff. You want to try just some granola with
sure.
Milky granola?
Yeah, since it's our breakfast.
All right, so.
We can have beef stroganoff.
Carefully add 1/2 cup of cold water. That's all?
Oh.
1/2 cup of cold water?
I have hot water. I was
wrong. Open package, tear package, remove and discard oxygen absorber. Okay.
I guess it's coffee time.
Add 1/2 cup of cold water. I thought you could eat it warm.
Yeah, me too. You want to try it warm?
Well, we got warm water. Of course, we got cold water too. Anyway, Mountain House Meals, granola. Let's see what happens.
Yeah. I'm going to keep this just in case. You might need it for something.
Yeah, you never know. Yeah. You're really careful about what you throw away out here. Yeah. Because you might need it.
It has little hooks on the end, sort of. You never know.
It's reconstituted and it's actually pretty good. After further reading, it says either hot or cold water. The instructions say cold, but anyway, your turn.
It's got blueberries in it.
Mm-hmm. We just let it set a few minutes, but I don't think you have to. I think you can probably just eat it right out of the, mm-hmm. right after you mix it together.
I think it has dry milk in it.
It does, definitely dry milk.
It's good.
Yeah, it doesn't look bad, it's good. Mm-hmm.
For
it's
sure.
definitely not bacon pancakes and for, like, you know, my favorite birthday breakfast, but.
Yeah, it's his birthday.
It's good enough in a pinch. Mm-hmm. If you're ever driving along and you find an interesting road and you have some of these with you and some water and a way to heat it, you're good to go. Don't need a lot of fancy prep. Don't have to do a lot of fancy meals. And it looks like the dog's interested.
Yeah, Cameo wants it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so here we are at the base of this rim rock. It's quite imposing. It's probably 30 feet tall. And there's probably all kinds of critters and who knows what lives along here. Monica's finding photographs everywhere. Of twisty trees and gnarly rocks and lizards, scorpions, goyse trees, yep. It's all here. Okay, we're up on top of the rim rock now, looking down over the dry lake bed. And off in the distance is Hampton Buttes. And somewhere down there is our campground. I'm going right out of it. Anyway, we're going to walk up this little gully here between these two things of rocks. See if we can find some human activity, maybe, from a long time ago. And you found?
Animal hole.
Oh, yeah.
He's probably going to get us.
Could be. I don't see any fresh tracks in or out.
No.
But I would avoid it anyway. Could be a wolverine or a badger. Oh, look at this. Happy birthday to me.
That is so great.
Yeah.
That is so fun.
Happy birthday to me. Well, I'm going to have to take it with me because
yes,
I just can't.
Birthday gift from God.
Thank you, God.
Yeah.
And this draw gets narrower and narrower as we go. This would seem like a good place for human activity, but we're not seeing anything really on the ground, like shards of obsidian or arrowheads or anything like that. But like Monica said, it's kind of like a scene from a movie. Good place to get ambushed by Indians. Or other cowboys.
Some kind of poop there.
Yeah, that's probably coyote. We don't care about poop. We're not looking for poop. But we're finding it. Nice. So here comes Monica, who's half my age. She should be able to make it down. Too much fun.
With the red lipstick.
With the red lipstick. Well, you gotta look good in the woods.
Yeah.
There we go. I think we've made it.
You never know.
Okay, well, we've walked quite a little ways. We could always walk farther, I suppose. My hips are feeling it. And if I were in better shape, and the only way to really get in better shape is to do this kind of thing. So I'm hoping this acts like a, acts to keep me young. We'll see. But there's lots of beauty around here. The sun's out and it's bright, shiny. And it's actually getting warm. So we've got about a 20-minute walk back to the Jeep. And who knows, we might put on some Mountain House meals for lunch.
That beef stroganoff, I was liking that.
The beef stroganoff sounds good to you?
Yeah.
Okay.
But after walking this, we might have to not share.
No, I might have to have your own, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
I do have cheese in my pocket.
I don't know. They're $7 or $8 a piece. I don't know if...
You want some cheese? Cheese, please?
Yeah, I'll have cheese. Sure. Why not? Emergency protein.
Yeah.
Yeah, my phone's been blowing up all day. I've been getting phone calls. You know, we're not that far from Hampton. But, yeah, phone's been blown up with birthday wishes, and that's nice. So.
Yes, he likes them. And then he got his balloon.
Yep.
Even though this morning I told him I didn't pack any balloons, birthday balloons for him, and what happened?
The universe
gave me a
birthday balloon. Yeah, it's probably 10 years old or so.
Just laying up there for you to find.
It was just laying up there for me to find. Why couldn't it have been a nice arrowhead or spear point? Why did it have to be an old Mylar balloon?
Because it said happy birthday.
Anyway, we did not leave it up there. We are bringing it back, and it will go in the trash-a-roo. So, all right, I got to pay attention because it's getting rocky, and you know, I'm getting older, and I have to be careful. Watch my step. Sooner or later, I'll quit making jokes about my age. Sooner or later.
Part of an old car.
Where's part of an old car?
Right here, my hand.
Oh. Oh, okay. I guess so. I don't know what that's part of, but it could be an old car. I suppose you're right. Yeah. So we're finding lots of treasures. Part of an old car.
I'll put it back so somebody else can find it.
That's right. Put it back for the next generation. You'll appreciate that, Casey. Anyway, we're out for a walk down here to the edge of this dry lake. And we're coming across quite a few bits and pieces of quartz.
Obsidian.
Yeah, so, and since it's not native to this area, then it had to be brought here by Native Americans. This piece here is kind of interesting. It's probably chip off of something that they were working on, but it looks like somebody tried to fracture the edges. Yeah, right along here.
Yeah. And then maybe that corner where they tie it off broke.
Yep. It's not quite a fully formed arrowhead, but it might have broke on them and they tried something else. Okay. So, old Olympia beer can. It says right on there, Olympia beer. Right here in front of this old ghost tree. This is a ghost tree, or what they call a ghost tree. The natives believe that their ancestors inhabit those, and so they're kind of sacred.
They're beautiful.
Yeah. You all in? Well, the temperature is supposed to be really cold tonight. We weren't really prepared for that, so we kind of packed up late and we thought we'd just take the long way home, and we found this nice trail. It's a little rough through there, but it looks really nice in here with the rim rock, and there's a road there that goes off to the right that goes down to the lake bed. So we're headed home, but we're going to take our time, and we might catch a nice sunset. If we do, we'll try to put it on film here for you. We're at a place called Hayes Well. There's actually a spring, I guess, or a well that flows out of the ground here, and they've tried to get it in a trough that transfers to another trough, which is not working. It's just kind of probably plugged up. Yeah, well, I'm not
gonna unplug it?
No, I'm not gonna unplug it for him now.
Uh-oh.
Oh, yeah,
he's mad. Where's he at?
Yeah, he's right here somewhere. I don't have good enough footing though to find him. Yeah. He's back in there somewhere. Anyway, kind of an interesting stop. I imagine they expected it to fill that little depression there, but they ain't working anymore, so whatever. Yep, that's Indian Lake, and it looks like it's come up here.
Seeping here.
First time we've been in four-wheel drive since we got off the pavement. Oh, looks like people drive around that. Oh well.
Oh.
I guess because they have to.
Yeah.
We don't have to drive that. I don't see a road going off that. Oh, here it is, right here. This is a road that runs down to this dry lake.
Yeah. Indian Lake.
Oh yeah, and I'm sure people have driven right across it.
It was like a big bird that just flew across. Maybe it was a duck or something, but it was a big bird. See?
Yep. Nope. Mm. But whatever.
Yeah. We'll get a good shot of the sunset.
Yeah, as we turn here towards the west, it's going to get very bright. You see Frederick Butte. Oh. Now you know where we are. Damn.
You can cut that out.
I can cut that out. Yeah, just mute it.
Greetings once again to all my followers out there. Last time I did any filming was when we were out at the ancient lake bed in the middle of central Oregon. And we didn't get a chance quite to finish some of the tips and tricks and suggestions for you geriatrics out there like myself who are in their 60s and somewhat overweight, and I thought I'd finish my treatise on geriatric overlanding. There's a couple of things I didn't get to show you guys, and a couple of things, tips that I wanted to tell you about when it comes to these rooftop tents. Now, I went over coming down out of the rooftop tent. I like to come down forward. And Monica, she'll spin around up there and come down backwards. I don't like not knowing where my feet are going to land. And usually I'm dangling my legs out anyway, so I'll just step right on down. Now, the rungs on the ladder are pretty narrow. And so if you're not wearing your shoes, it kind of hurts your feet. So this time I'm wearing my hikers that tie up. I can loosen these up and they'll slip right on and slip right off very easily. So what I will do is I will put these on in the morning before I come down the ladder, and it saves your feet because the rungs are pretty narrow and it hurts, especially if you're my size and weight. So getting out is one thing, getting in is another. And you might say, well, what's that all about? You just climb up the ladder and you get in. Yes, you do. The very first time we did that, I was wearing a very large jacket. It was cold outside. It was in the 30s. And we're finally going to go to bed. And a couple of things that I noted from that, and I wanted to pass along to you. First of all, take that jacket off and put it in the back seat. Stash it somewhere, because you get up there in the tent, and unless you can stand on your knees, which I have trouble doing, it gives me pain. You're going to struggle to get that jacket off, and then you've got it up there with you. Now, sure, you can throw it over you while you're in the sleeping bag. That's one option. But I decided that before I get in my tent again, I'm going to take my jacket off and stash it somewhere. Just don't wait until you're up there crowded in there with someone else to try to take that big bulky jacket off. Okay, second tip when getting in the tent. Do not just climb up the ladder and flop on top of that sleeping bag. You do that and you're outside the sleeping bag. And if you're like me, it's a struggle now to try to get into that sleeping bag. So before you get in, unzip that sleeping bag all the way. It's not going to be any warmer or any colder if it's wide open than if it's closed. Zip it open, flap it all the way back, or as far back so that you don't have to struggle to get in to your sleeping bag. You're already in it. So I usually will do that, and then take my pants and shirt off. You can stash them inside the sleeping bag with you if you want them warm in the morning. You can use them for pillow padding. What I'll usually do is I'll put my inflatable pillow inside my shirt. Gives it a nice kind of a pillowcase. And you won't be struggling now to get into your sleeping bag because you're not laying on top of it. So that's the best I got for you. I forgot to mention it during the last video. So there's that. Okay, one other modification I made to the Jeep, and it's strictly age related, and I'll show you that here next. Okay, the next dilemma involves the truck itself. Now I've gone to the effort to cover this bed up with the soft topper and then put a rack over it. I've also got a spot here for my Max Tracks, which I'm using to level the Jeep out for this overnight camp out. The downside to having a cover like this and anything attached to the sides, including the rack, is you lose accessibility to the front of the bed. And this is something I struggled with my very first camp out, because how do you get your stuff from in front? So you think, okay, well, you just open the tailgate. Well, you open the tailgate and now you're 18 inches farther away. So what am I doing? Getting up on the tailgate and crawling in through the hole, like so. Still can't reach it. So dilemma is solved. By very simply installing that's the bed slide 1000 CL, made for the Jeep Gladiator or just about any 5 foot bed. Man, I'll tell you what, this thing has saved my bacon, because now I don't have to climb in there. I can reach everything from one side or the other. And when you're my age, with my physical abilities declining, sorry, it happens, I'm not an 18-year-old anymore. I needed the extra help. And so that was an excellent solution right there. Well worth the money. They're a little over $1,000, but I'll tell you what, if you're gonna do this and you're gonna do it right and you're gonna save your body, this is a good option, a really good option. Okay, so this bed slide 1000 here, CL, has a 1,000-pound capacity. And you say, well, that ain't very much. Well, it's more than I need, because I probably don't have more than 300 or 400 pounds of gear that goes in there. But look how easy it is to reach. All this area here is within my reach. And it doesn't matter how heavy this stuff is, it works really well for me. The installation was pretty straightforward, although that was a challenge also, because guess what? That's right. You got to get up in there on your hands and knees after you've got it centered about where you want it. And then I had Monica unlock the drawer and pull me out enough so that I can mark the holes. Pull me out all the way so I could mark the rear holes. And then we had to remove the entire bed slide out, drill, and put the what do they call those nuts that smash? I forget what they're called. Anyway, four of them. Drilling through the bed, you know, the metal is fairly thin, so that wasn't an issue. As a matter of fact, it turned out to be a bit of a challenge, because as soon as the drill bit bites through, it just pulls you right down to the floor, because The metal is so thin that once it breaks through, it'll draw the drill bit right down. What else? Yeah, once you get the D-nuts or jam nuts or pack nuts, I forget what they're called. They've got a name. You just put it back in there. I got on top of it on my hands and knees and lined it up as best I could, and then had Monica pull the drawer out part way, and I drove in the nuts, pulled it the rest of the way out, cinched it all down. Pretty straightforward, took about an hour. I'll tell you what, saves me a lot of time and energy. Okay, so that's a quick look at the build so far. Oh, this is a nice spot here. I've got the awning out and the tent up and the bed slide, man. Made it easy, not even out of breath. I'll be cooking up some dinner here tonight. I brought a steak, and I'm actually gonna try to actually cook something rather than do the Mountain House meals. As good as they are, I thought I'd do a little bit of camp cooking tonight. So hang around for that. And thanks for watching. This channel is supported by viewers like you, and I really appreciate those that have subscribed and like, and especially your comments. So keep them coming.